إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله. Indeed, the most truthful of speech is the book of Allah. وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the best guidance is the guidance of our beloved messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. وشر الأمور محدثاتها. And the worst of affairs are those things we newly invent into this religion of ours. وَكُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ And everything we newly invent into this religion of ours is an innovation. وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ And every innovation is misguidance and it leads astray. وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ Every going astray and every misguidance is in the hellfire. ثُمَّ أَمَّا بَعْدْ My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has blessed us by seeing this month in commemoration of the month in which this book, this Qur'an, the words and the speech of Allah was revealed as the final message for all of mankind. Allah says, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمُ وَيُبَشِّرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا كَبِيرًا Allah, He says in the Qur'an, what means verily this Qur'an, it guides to that which is most just and that which is most right. And it gives glad tidings to the believers. Those who firmly hold to the Tawheed, to the oneness of Allah, that Allah is the only one we worship. His Lordship is complete and only belongs to Him. And His names and His attributes fully belong to Him. And that Muhammad ﷺ is His messenger and servant. Give glad tidings to these ones who work righteous deeds. They shall have a great reward, meaning paradise. Kitab Allah, the book of Allah, is the words and the speech of Allah. Huwa hablullah. It is the rope of Allah. Al-mamdud min as-sama'i ila al-ard. It is outstretched from the heavens to the earth. We don't physically see a rope hanging down, but the book of Allah is the connection to your Creator. وَأَبْشِرُوا فَإِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ طَرَفَهُ بِيَدِ اللَّهِ وَطَرَفَهُ بِأَيْدِيكُمْ فَتَمَسَّكُوا بِهِ Know that this Qur'an, have glad tidings, because one end of it is in the hand of Allah, and the other end is in your hand, so hold firmly to it and cling to it, grab onto it. فَإِنَّكُمْ لَن تَهْلَكُوا وَلَن تَضِلُّوا بَعْدُهُ أَبْدًا And if you do so, you will never be destroyed, and you will never go astray after that. This book that Allah sent is not a created thing. He spoke these words to Jibreel alayhi salam to bring to the best of mankind our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam over a span of 23 years. And in it was powerful messages. Last week we reviewed the message of sadaqah, of charity. And this week we want to highlight how much Allah calls us to and highlighted dua, supplicating to Allah, to call upon Allah for help, for forgiveness, for aid, for guidance, and the likes of these matters. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الدعاء هو العبادة Our Prophet ﷺ, he said in the authentic hadith, دعاء, supplicating and calling upon your Lord is the essence, the epitome of worship. It is how you worship your Creator in one form. So when you call upon Allah, your true reliance is upon Him. You're showing that nothing and agreeing that nothing can happen without His granting of it, or His qadr, His decree. And this is the epitome of worship. Our father, Adam alayhi salam, when he had sinned and he was cast out of Jannah, he was taught, when he was sinned and cast out of Jannah, he was taught to seek forgiveness in the following way. رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسِنَا وَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ Adam alayhi salam, the one who was the first to be created with the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from dirt across the spans of the earth Allah created. When he sinned and was cast out of Jannah, He was taught how to seek forgiveness, even though he was a prophet of Allah, saying, "Oh, our Lord, we have wronged our own souls. If you forgive us not and bestow mercy on us not, then we will certainly be of those who are lost." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, قُلْ مَا يَأْبَأُ بِكُمْ رَبِّي لَوْلَا دُعَاءُكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, what means, say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the kuffar, to the disbelievers, my Lord pays attention to you only because of your dua of him. This is why he was said to the disbelievers. Now what about the Muslim who's upon the correct tawheed and the correct aqidah, who calls upon Allah, knowing that nothing happens without Allah's decree. This is why Allah pays attention to the people, because they turn to him, and it's the complete sign that you're truly reliant upon him and his qadr and what he decides for you in this life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the Quran, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِي إِذَا دَعَانِ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, what means, again, we're going back to the book of Allah in this month, even though it should be a daily occurrence for us to review and learn and memorize and implement the book of Allah if we want to be successful. But look at how much Allah pointed to dua in this ayah. He said, when my servant asks you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, concerning me, indeed I am near. For clarification, we should never hear anyone say Allah is everywhere. This is incorrect without a doubt, according to the Quran and the Sunnah. Allah himself said that he created the heavens and earth. الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى عَلَى الْعَرْشِ. Allah created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, though he could have done it in the blink of an eye. And then he ascended above his throne in a manner which suits his majesty. So you have the creation, and separate and above the creation is the arsh of Allah, the throne of Allah, and above his arsh is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what does it mean when he says it's near? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ. And we are closer to mankind. We are closer to mankind than even their jugular vein. The vein in the midst of your neck that takes blood back to your heart. This vein, how close it is to you in the depth of your body, this is how close Allah is to you with what? With his ilm, with his knowledge, with his eyesight, with his hearing, knowing your innermost thought, even though everyone around you might not know what you're thinking. So Allah said, and when my servants ask you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, concerning me, tell them I am near. I respond to the invocation of the one who makes dua, supplicates to me and calls upon me. So let them respond to me with obedience and believe in me, that they may be rightly guided, that they may be rightly guided to the straight path. Our Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, the father of the prophets, the one who was thrown in a pit of fire and Allah commanded the fire to cool down and not burn him. The one who told and advised his father to leave off shirk, and he left all of that only to the dismay and the harm that the people of his qawm would cause upon him. But what did he say? He himself would also, being one of the five revered prophets, the most five revered prophets, he himself would make dua. رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي رَبَّنَا وَتَقَبَّلْ دُعَاءِ. Oh my Lord, make me of those who establish the prayer, and make my descendants of those who establish the prayer. رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَوْمُ الْحِسَابِ. My Lord, forgive me for my sins and wrongs. This is a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asking for forgiveness. And many of us, that word is not even uttered on our tongue daily. When our own Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say, كَانَ يَسْتَغْفِرَ اللَّهِ فِي الْيَوْمِ مِئَةَ مَرَّةٍ. And he would say istighfar in the day 100 times, and he was promised the highest of Jannah. So Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, he continued his dua, my Lord, forgive me for my sins, forgive my parents for their sins, and forgive all the believers that follow until the day of account is established. So الدُّعَاء هو العبادة. Dua is ibadah. وما هي العبادة. So what is عبادة? عبادة هي اسم جامع لكل ما يجيبه الله ويرضاه من الأقوال والأعمال الظاهرة والباطنة والبراءة مما ينافي ذلك ويضاده. What is ibadah? It is a comprehensive name for everything that Allah loves and everything that Allah is pleased with, from what is apparent and what is hidden, from statements of the tongue to the actions of your limbs, and freedom from what negates it or encompasses it. Al-ibadah هي تألت القلب بالحب والخضوع. So ibadah is the devotion of your heart with love along with humility. These aspects of love and humility must be present for you to devote yourself to Allah. And if you devote yourself to Allah, this is the devotion sharia that is legislated in our sharia. And if you don't, if you devote yourself or your action or anything to other than Allah, then this is the devotion of shirk, the devotion that's shirkiya. So we must clarify this in our ibadah, that we're always doing things that will please and help Allah. From the minor things, that you help your spouse in the home. This is from ibadah. The woman sometimes may complain that she's cooking. This is ibadah for her to do so for her family. This is worship for her. And the likes of these matters. Playing with the children. It is ibadah because it's something that Allah loves and Allah is pleased with. Spending time with the spouse, and we're just focusing on just that aspect, because we see a lot of disconnect there. So this is what worship is. So what action is considered ibadah? From our actions that we do, what is considered ibadah? From what Allah loves, from what Allah is pleased with. It has to have devotion of the heart with love and humility. If two things are completed, they're completed along with love and humility. As Allah the Most High says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. And those who believe, they are the ones who are stronger in their love for Allah. And then He, subhanahu wa ta'ala, He combined them, He brought them all together in this ayah in Surah Al-Anbiya. إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ وَيَدْعُونَنَا رَغَبًا وَرَهَبًا وَكَانُوا لَنَا خَاشِعِينَ. Allah said, bringing them together, and they, indeed, they who hasten, who used to hasten to do good deeds, and they used to supplicate to us and make dua to us in hope of His mercy and getting Jannah, in fear of His punishment being sent to the hellfire, and they were to us humbly submissive. So ibadah has to have devotion to Allah with love and humility completely dedicated to our Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. This dua isn't just for you to do for yourself. An Abi Darda radiallahu anhu qala qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam da'wat al-muslim li akhihi bi dhahr al-ghayb mustajaba. He said, a Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a Muslim supplication for his absent brother, meaning your brother can't hear you make this dua, but you're making dua for your brother or your sister in Islam, it will be answered. It will be answered. عند رأسه ملك موكل كلما دعا لأخيه بخير قال الملك الموكل به آمين ولك بمثل. آمين ولك بمثل. So what happens for you even when you make dua for your brother and he doesn't know you're making it for him? There's an angel sitting by your head, and as long as you're making dua for your brother in Islam or your sister in Islam, the angel by your head that's entrusted with you, that and you're asking for your brother good, that's put in charge of you, that angel will say Ameen, and may you receive the same good you're asking for your brother and your sister. Qatada, he asked Anas, which supplication did the Prophet ﷺ say make the most? And he said that he used to say the most, or most often, رَبَّنَا أَتَنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً. The one promised the highest of Jannah, the final messenger, the seal of the Anbiya, Khatam al-Anbiya al-Mursaleen, would all constantly say, رَبَّنَا أَتَنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً. Oh, our Lord, give us good in this life. وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً. Give us good in the hereafter. وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. And save us from the torment of the hellfire. وزاد زياد وكان أنس إذا أراد أن يدعو بدعوة دعا بها وإذا أراد أن يدعو بدعاء دعا بها فيها. The version of Ziyad, he adds, when Anas used to supplicate or make dua, he uttered this supplication, ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. He would utter this supplication, and when he uttered other supplications, other dua, he would also put in this supplication with it to show you its importance and its weight. Our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in an authentic hadith, إِنَّهُ مَنْ لَمْ يَسْأَلُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى يَغْضَبْ عَلَيْهِ. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is, in this hadith actually, Shaykh al-Wada'i rahimahullah, he said that it's da'if, but Shaykh al-Albani, he placed it as authentic in As-Silsilat al-Ahadith al-Sahihah. So in taking the fact that there's some khilaf, still look at the meaning of this hadith, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, indeed, the one who does not ask Allah, the Most High, then Allah becomes angry with him. Allah becomes angry with him. It is the epitome of worship. The epitome of a slave who needs his master to help him and guide him and aid him in every way whatsoever to ask of him. So this is why it is so valuable. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ اَدْعُونِ يَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ إِبَادَتِي سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ. Allah says what means, and your Lord says, call upon me so that I may respond to you. And we've given the khutbah of some people who say, why is my dua not accepted? And from that list, and we'll remind ourselves of that in future khutbah, from that list, you know the Quran, you don't act upon it. You know the Sunnah, you abandon it. You know Jahannam and you don't want to go to it, but you do nothing to stay away from it. You know Jannah and you want it, but you're not doing the works to earn it. You have food put on your table, more than you can imagine, and you don't praise Allah for it. You look down on the faults of the people, instead of looking at your own faults, and likewise. So never question why your dua isn't accepted, because it could be accepted with something being granted for you much better, in this life or in Jannah. وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌّ لَكُمْ. Sometimes you may think something is good for you, but it's really bad for you. And Allah knows, and you do not know. So Allah said in this ayah, and your Lord says, call upon me, I will respond to you. Indeed, those who disdain my worship, those who are so arrogant and proud that they cannot call upon me, they cannot call upon me with dua, then they will enter into hellfire, rendered contemptible. Turn to Allah, beg of Allah in this blessed month and at all times and in all places. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أعجز الناس من عجز عن الدعاء وأدخل الناس من بخل بالسلام. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said in this hadith with Sheikh Al-Albani, he graded as sahih in its isnad, marfu'an, mawqufan, wasahha marfu'an. He said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, the most incapable of people is the one who's incapable of making dua. This is the person who has the least capability. And the most cheap or greedy of people, miserly of people, is the one who is bad with giving the salams. They don't give the salams to the other people. From the benefits and the virtues that we should do when we make dua so that it aids you, is again going back to the Quran and to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Our Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, دعوة ذي النون, يعني يونس عليه السلام, إذا دعا بها وهو في بطن الحوت, لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين. لم يدعو بها رجل مسلم في شيء قط إلا استجاب الله له. Look at how much we're missing when we make dua and we think we're doing enough just by raising our hands or by pleading to Allah. In this hadith we see what is clear in our deficiencies. The dua of the noon of Yunus alayhi salam, when he was in the belly of the fish, he said, La ilaha illa ant, there is no deity worthy of worship except for you. Subhanak, you are perfect in every way whatsoever. Inni kuntu min al-zalimin, indeed I am from the oppressors and the wrongdoers. No Muslim, he ever says this phrase when he makes dua to Allah, except that Allah will respond to your dua. How many of you say this dua when you make your other ad'iyah, when you make your other dua or supplications to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Look how much we're missing by not having the knowledge of our deen. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَا يَزَالُ يُسْتَجَابُ لِلْعَبْدِ مَا لَمْ يَدْعُ بِإِثْمٍ أَوْ قَطِيعَةِ رَحِمٍ مَا لَمْ يَسْتَعْجَلُ. قِيلَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَا الْاِسْتِعْجَالُ قَالَ يَقُولُ قَدْ دَعَوْتُ فَلَمْ أَرَى يَسْتَجِيبُ لِي فَيَسْتَحْسِرُ عِنْدَ ذَلِكَ وَيَدْعُ الدُّعَاءِ. In the authentic hadith that we have muttafaqun alayhi in Bukhari and Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the servant will continue to have his supplication answered by Allah as long as you don't ask for sin or cut off the family ties, and as long as you are not impatient. The Sahaba, they asked him, what is this impatience? مَا الْاِسْتِعْجَالِ. What is this impatience that you're referring to? He says that the person will say, I supplicated again and again. I made dua, I made it again and again. And yet my dua was not answered. So he becomes frustrated and he gives up that form of supplicating. Never give it up, because what you're asking for may not be what's best for you. And Allah may have something better in store for you, for your sabr, for your patience, and your contentment with His qadar. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, أقرب ما يكون العبد من ربه وهو ساجد فأكثر الدعاء. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said in the authentic hadith that we find in the Sunnah of Nasa'i, he said, the closest that a slave is to his or her Lord is when they're in sajda, in prostration. The thing that we see so many brothers, for the brothers, the sisters might see the sisters doing like a bird pecking on the ground looking for food, doing so quickly, so hurriedly, with no khushu, with no idea, no remembrance that in that position you are the closest you are to your Lord, to His pleasure, to His help, to His assistance, to His guidance, to His tathbeet, to His firmness on this deen for you in that sajda. And yet some just making sajda as if it's just an action they need to check off so they can say that they did their salah. The closest you are to your Lord is in that sajda. So when you're in that position, make dua. فَأَكْثِرُ dua. Make a lot of dua. Yet you still have someone say, well, I learned from a shaykh or a mawla or whatever, I'm not supposed to make dua in sujood. وَالْعَيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. It's in the authentic ahadith. Where are you going? To other people. Be careful who you take your deen from, ya akhwani wa akhwati fillah. Go back to the Quran, the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how it was understood and lived and implemented by the sahaba radiallahu anhum. وَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Then you go back to the people of knowledge, who will then refer everything to you as an answer back to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to give you the clear answer that you need. Not who just talks out of their own mind or whims or desires. That sajda is the best place you can make dua. It is the best place. If you can stay in it for 2 minutes, stay in it for 2 minutes and beg, cry, weep, plead from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide you and to help you. Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, من فتح له منكم باب الدعاء فتحت له أبواب الرحمة. Whoever has a door opened for him or her to make dua, then really this is the door of mercy that Allah is opening for you. فَعَلَيْكُمْ عِبَادَ اللَّهِ بِالدُّعَاءِ. So the Prophet ﷺ, he said, it is a must, O servants of Allah. If we want to be called عباد الله, servants of Allah, it is a must that you supplicate and call upon Allah for guidance and help and aid. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله يقول أنا عند ظن عبدي بي وأنا معه إذا دعاني. In this hadith Qudsi, this authentic hadith that we find in Sahih Muslim, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I am as my servant expects of me, and I am with him when he calls upon me. When he calls upon me. If you want Allah to be with you, to aid you, to guide you, to decree for you what is best because He knows and we do not know, then you call upon Allah and you accept whatever result ends up after that. Call upon Allah and He will be with you to aid you and support you in ways that you may not see that way, but in ways that will come out with you, inshallah, entering Jannah and being able to see His face. And lastly, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he narrates in the hadith, and pay attention to it, and we'll remind the whole hadith because there's benefit in it. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رغم أنف رجل ذكرت عنده فلم يصلي عليه. The first thing the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, may the person be humiliated. Imagine being humiliated, embarrassed beyond belief to a degree where you don't want to show your face ever again. May he be humiliated. The one who hears my name, Prophet Muhammad, Rasulullah, Nabiyullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and does not send salah upon me. Not when the khutbah is going on, because your right is more to listen to the khutbah than to say that dua. Okay? But at other times, and yet, you will still mention the Prophet's name, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and go over a hadith, and this and that, and you'll have some Muslims not even say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The lips have to move. Utter it. Say it. Teach it to your children so they know this. Especially on Fridays. Because this is a path for the shifa'ah, for the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَرَغْمَ أَنْفُ رَجُلٍ دَخَلَ عَلَيْهِ رَمَضَانِ ثُمَّ انْسَلَخَ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَغْفَرَ لَهُ. And may he be humiliated and embarrassed to shame, the one who Ramadan enters upon him and it leaves before he is forgiven. This is the month of maghfirah, the month of forgiveness, the month of tawbah, the month of turning to Allah. Ramadan to Ramadan, the minor sins can be forgiven if we're doing it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In these last 10 nights, which Allah a'lam begins Sunday night, there's a night, khayrun min alfi shahr, better than 1,000 months, 83 years. Most of us won't live 83 years. 82 years, better than 83 years, that one night, the dua you make to Allah, begging Him to forgive you for your sins. We all have them, and they reach the skies, they reach the foam, they're more than the foam of the ocean. But Allah is willing to forgive it if you call upon Him. Do not let Ramadan enter and leave you without being forgiven. وَرَغِمَ أَنْفُ رَجُلٍ أَدْرَكَ عِنْدَهُ أَبَوَاهُ الْكِبْرَ فَلَمْ يُدْخَلَاهُ الْجَنَّةِ. And then he finally said, and may he be humiliated, the man or the woman whose parents reached old age in their presence, meaning you were alive while your parents were old and needing help, assistance, financially, physically, a phone call, emotionally, whatever it takes to just show them you love them, you care for them, after all the struggles they did for you, from the times you can't even remember, those years of birth, 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, 4 year, we don't even remember anything in our life from that time, for the most part. May he be humiliated, the one whose parents reach old age in his presence, and they were not a cause for him to enter paradise, to enter Jannah. My brothers and sisters, let us make dua sincerely to Allah that we implement this important message in the Quran of dua and be of those who supplicate to Allah. To Allah. أقول قولي هذا استغفر الله لي ولكم ادعو الله يغفر لكم جميعا. Zakat. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونصلي ونسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا وبعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Ibn al-Jawzi رحمه الله, he said, when the horse is racing, it knows when it's nearing the finish line. And the one riding the horse knows when it's getting to the finish line. So it exerts every effort to win that race. Every effort to win that race. Verily, our deeds are judged by the last deeds we do before our death, and we know that can come young, old, healthy, sick at any time. So he said, do not allow the racehorse to be more clever than you. Verily, deeds are judged by their conclusions. So if you didn't do well welcoming Ramadan till this point, then perhaps you can do better bidding it farewell. Perhaps, as we wind down these days and we're rounding that final base to hit to home, and we get to that day of Eid and we run out of another Ramadan that Allah blessed us and gave us provisions with and gave us blessings in and favors upon favors by allowing us to fast to Him. We don't owe Allah anything. We owe Allah everything. Allah doesn't owe us nothing. As you didn't do good up until now, that home stretch, the end of that race is coming. So do good as we get to the point where we bid it farewell. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he narrated, فَرَضَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ زَكَاةُ الْفِطْرُ تُهْرَةً لِلصَّائِمِ مِنَ الْغَوِّ وَالْرَفَثِ وَتُعْمَةً لِلْمَسَاكِينِ فَمَنْ أَدَّهَا قَبْلَ الصَّلَاةِ فَهِيَ زَكَاةٌ مَقْبُولَةٌ وَمَنْ أَدَّهَا بَعْدَ الصَّلَاةِ فَهِيَ صَدَقَةٌ مِنَ الصَّدَقَاتِ. In this authentic hadith that we have in the Sunnah of Abi Dawood and Ibn Majah, and it is authentic, the Prophet ﷺ was said to have enjoined by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he enjoined zakat al-fitr on the one who fasts during the month of Ramadan to purify his fasting from any indecent actions or speech that he or she did, and for the purpose of giving food to the poor. It is an accepted zakat if you give it before the Eid prayer, and this zakat we're going to explain is not money, it's the food getting out, and it's a sadaqah from the normal charities if you do it after. On the male, the female, the free, the slave, the young, the old. Even Uthman radiallahu anhu, if there was a fetus in the womb of the wife, he considered paying on that as well. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, as we're getting towards the end of Ramadan, every year we collect zakat al-fitr. It does not go one penny into the hands of anyone. We do what is legislated in our deen with it, which is نُخْرِجَهَا بِطَعَامٍ. يعني we have to send it out as food. This is how we have to give it out. Every year, we have given to over 25 or so families locally who we know are in need. And we send money to Yemen, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and to trustworthy people who go and buy food, rice and staple foods, and give them to the poor people, give them to the needy. Because we don't have enough here to cover what we collect. We need to start collecting it from now. Be careful of the boxes that are designated for zakat al-mal. We'll collect it between now and next week, inshallah, so that we can get out. $10 per person per household. The cost of things have gone up, and this is what it takes. If you have a fidya because you're of an old age, or you're ill and you won't be able to make up your fasting because your illness is permanent, the fidya is half of that amount. It's one sa' for zakat al-fitr, it's half of a sa', so about $7. For the one who has a fidya to pay for fasting, they will not be able to make up because they couldn't, because of the legislated reasons, inshallah. You can put that in the same box, or if you give it to me, we can get that money over to feed some people before the end of Ramadan even. So please give your zakat al-fitr as soon as you can in the box legislated, so we can disperse it according to what is allowed of us in the sunnah. And again, this purifies the mistakes in your fasting, and it gives food to the needy ones. An update from last week's drive, alhamdulillah, half of the traffic signals, we're not putting that many, by the way, I've been asked that question. We just gave a concept of splitting up what we have to put in into 120 parts. And this came to $3,000 a signal or $1,000 a light. We reached, alhamdulillah, 60 traffic signals, about $180,000. The rest of the month, inshallah, we need to push hard. If you can't give any more, send the message to 5-10 people, because whatever they give, they will get reward, and you will get the reward, the same reward they get without decreasing from their reward, based on the authentic hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. So there's still work we can do to have that total amount collected so we can get to some other humanitarian causes that need some help as well. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك أنت السميع المجيب قريب الدعوات اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.